We must move on now to questions to the Minister of Education, and I call Danny Kennedy.
With your permission, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I will answer questions 1, 2, 13 and 14 together. I believe that is in the best interest of learners here to continue with the well-established grading using ladders. Requiring all GCSEs here to be graded in this way will avoid unnecessary complexity. It is very disappointing that some organisations are choosing to put commercial interests ahead of the needs of our young people and will no longer be offering their GCSE qualifications here. I want to assure pupils and parents that our young people will continue to be able to access a wide range of subjects and courses from SEA and WJEC and other awarding organisations. My department has written to schools with initial guidance, including arrangements for those pupils who are already working towards 9-to-1 GCSEs in maths and English literature, provided by those awarding bodies that have now decided to leave us. Further guidance will be shortly provided on the alternatives available to fill the gaps that emerge in the range of GCSEs on offer as a result of their decisions. It is, of course, important that qualifications offered here are relevant and appropriate for our young people and our economy. It is also vital that qualifications offered here continue to be recognised by universities and employers across these islands and indeed beyond. Systems are already in place to allow comparisons to be made between exams outcomes here and other jurisdictions across these islands and indeed beyond. My decision on GCSE grading does not change any of that.
I call Danny Kennedy.
Sir, Mr. Deputy Speaker, listen closely to the Minister's answers. One of the key selling points for the Northern Ireland education system is the fact that traditionally our pupils get better A-level, AS and GCSE results than their compatriots in England and Wales. Does the Minister agree that we should protect that record? And does he agree also that it is essential that we should compare and benchmark our performance to other parts of the United Kingdom, especially in key subjects?
Yes and yes. But none of the decisions I've made to date will change that. We will still be comparable to England, we will be comparable to Wales, we will be comparable to Scotland, and we will be comparable to the south of Ireland. None of the decisions I've made negate or do away with such comparability across these islands. It's vitally important that we measure our education system against our nearest neighbours or other jurisdictions. It's also vitally important that we're able to measure our education system against the leading education systems in the world. And while I fully understand as to why, and it's only natural, that we would compare our qualifications when it comes to the summer awarding time to England, but we have to move beyond that. That's nothing to do with this decision, I have to say. But we have to move beyond that. We have to be comparing with the leading education systems across the world and ensuring that our students are matching those as well.
I call John Dallett.
I've listened very carefully to the Minister and the answers he's given. I wonder, would the Minister agree with me that it's bad enough having two examination systems on this small island without introducing a third one? And would he agree with me that when employers are assessing people for jobs, they may not be as knowledgeable about what the grades are than perhaps the Minister or myself as a former teacher might be?
Well, the reality is that we have two different qualification systems in this island, and we have now divergence across the GCSE grading in these islands. Wales have maintained the alphabetical awarding system, as have I, and as you're aware, England have moved to a 9-to-1 system. Scotland have their own qualifications. That is the reality of the situation. It is the reality of devolved government. Devolved institutions will make decisions which they believe in the best interest of their students. In terms of employers, employers are now dealing with qualifications from across Europe, and the debate around the Brexit and our relationship with Europe is relevant here as well, because with the influx of European workers into our economy, employers, particularly major employers, are now dealing with qualifications from a range of European countries. Our universities are dealing with a range of qualifications from not only Europe but from around the globe, and all managed perfectly well.
I call Sydney Anderson.
Good, Deputy Speaker. Can I thank the Minister for his response today on this particular issue? Minister, can I ask you what discussions you have had with teachers and their representatives on this issue before you actually made your decision regarding the grading change?
There was a consultation held in regards to this matter. It took place over a 12-week period. There was consultation responses from teachers, teachers' organisations, parents and pupils, and from business and other sectors in regards to this matter. As with many consultation responses, there's a variety of opinions, whether it be among teachers or other professions in regards to maintaining qualifications and how you score those qualifications. But the key message coming forward from the consultation responses was that we wanted to maintain or ensure that there was not confusion in relation to the publication of examination results with a variety of numbers and alphabetical scoring on the one award sheet being given to pupils.
I call Peter Weir.
Thank you, Speaker. Can I ask the Minister, in addition to the general concerns which have been raised on this by myself and others, to comment specifically on the issue of computer science GCSE and the comments particularly of Professor Crozier at the weekend of Queen's University, who has expressed a concern that the removal of the more technical computer science GCSE, which is currently provided by the English boards, that the current CCEA ICT computer science one is less technical and will leave Northern Ireland students at a disadvantage? And what assurance can he give that a course, a computer science GCSE, will be put in place which matches what is there from England?
SEA is currently developing a new GCSE in ICT, and importantly, they're developing it in conjunction with local employers and industry leaders in regards to that matter. Because I think that's the way forward in terms of qualifications. Developing them in conjunction with employers and leading academics in relation to the subject. And I'm confident that the new GCSE, which will be introduced by SEA, will have the same rigour and fortitude as the one which the professor commented over the weekend. We also have a very rigorous and recognised A-level in ICT, which is recognised by universities and others. So I listened to the concerns expressed over the weekend, and I listened to them carefully, but I'm satisfied that the course of action we have taken will not put our students at a disadvantage in relation to any subject, including computing.
I call Jim Allister.
The Minister must have known when he made his decision that English boards were not going to establish a separate marking system for Northern Ireland students. Therefore, he knew and presumably wanted the outcome to be to reduce the choice for schools and pupils in Northern Ireland. Isn't his agenda as obvious as it is political?
No, it is not political, it is educational. And I note that no one who has presented me with questions thus far during this debate has presented me with an educational argument not to carry out the decision I have made. You have chosen a political question rather than an educational question to confront me in relation to my decision, but I await someone challenging me for educational reasons. It was an education decision based on sound data, based on a consultation, and based on the needs of our local students. I think it will be a very unfortunate position for any minister to get into, to start making decisions based on the commercial needs of companies that provide services to whether it be health, whether it be education, or whether it be any other department in the executive. We have to make decisions which we believe are in the best needs of our young people. Then if commercial enterprises wish to follow, well, be good. If they don't wish to follow, so be it.
I call Phil Flanagan.
Can I make it the last question, Claudia Keisht, Everett 3, question number 3.
CCMS has a statutory duty to promote and coordinate in consultation with the trustees the planning of effective provision of Catholic-maintained schools. The statutory DP process facilitates extensive consultation and has two distinct stages. Prior to publication, the onus is on the proposer, in this case CCMS, to consult with the Board of Governors, teachers and parents of the affected schools. The Education Authority has also a duty to consult with all other schools likely to be affected. Once a DP is published, a two-month objection and comment period begins, during which anyone can make their views known directly to my department. During this stage, I endeavour to engage with concerned or interested parties to listen to their views on a proposal before I decide whether to approve it. The 2015 strategic plan for the post-primary schools states that the trustees recommend the phased development of two large single-sex schools in Enniskillen. The statutory development proposal to support that intent have not been published until they are. Neither I nor my department have any role.
I call Phil Flanagan for supplementary.
I thank the Minister for his answer. This is an issue that affects people across Fermanagh, not just in Enniskillen. And the four schools in question, St Michael's, St Joseph's, St Fanch's and Mount Lourdes, all provide excellent education to the students that attend it. But can I ask the Minister to outline at what stage his department and the Minister, whether it's he or his successor, will become involved in this process to ensure that the views of the local community are heard in this matter and that a decision taken in the best interests of the young people of Fermanagh is reached?
The only point I or the next Minister will become involved in this is if and when a development proposal or proposals are published in relation to the plans outlined by CCMS in one of their documents. At that stage, then, it's opened up to 2 months consultation where the Minister will engage with locally interested parties, the schools and others around the issue and take on board evidence, both verbal and written, from the various parties in relation to this matter. And only after that 2 month consultation can a decision be made.
I call Alistair Patterson.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. The Minister will probably be aware that there's a widely held view across Fermanagh that the schools in the control sector have been treated very differently to those in the maintained. The local control post-primaries in Keis, Ballinamallard, Listenskey have all been closed with a promise of a new build in Enniskillen, which in reality is some way off. Can he understand the frustration when local people see what is clearly an unfair approach taken with other valuable schools such as Brolla?
No, I don't accept your view on that matter. I have been involved in wide-scale consultations with a cross-section of the community in Fermanagh over my tenure as Minister. I was the Minister who brought forward the new bill for Devonish College. I was the Minister who defended the new bill for Devonish College when representatives from Fermanagh were telling me it would never happen. And I was saying, well, it's very desponding, I'm sure, for the Board of Governors of Devonish College to hear elected representatives standing up in the chamber and telling me that a build will never happen. The build is happening. Devonish College will rise up as a new school in the near future, and there's already work taking place on site to deal with the difficult lay of the land in that area. The delay in dealing with and improving educational facilities in the control sector in Fermanagh is as much to do with those who refuse to accept the need for change as it is for those who want to promote change. And the recent judgment, only on Wednesday or Thursday of last, shows that the decision I made in relation to Pretoria and Collegiate was the correct one. The judge rejected 29 of the, I think it was originally 32 points of appeal brought forward. Several of them were dropped during the case. But the judge rejected every point of appeal brought forward and said that the Minister's decision was both correct and rational. So we now have the programme for change that is needed in the control sector, and I am determined to back that up with investment in new schools for the control sector in Fermanagh.
I call Dolores Kelly.
Speaker, on the principle of shared education, Minister, have you added any additional caveats or conditions that schools must comply with in order to avail of shared education funding? For example, having to participate in Key Stage 3 assessments?
Can I welcome the member to her role as education spokesperson? I look forward to locking horns with you. But in terms of this is an issue that goes back several months. And I have included a caveat that schools should report back on levels of progression. And why wouldn't I? Why wouldn't I insist that schools report back on levels of progression when we're talking about quite a significant investment of public funds in a scheme which is about shared education and ensuring that shared education not only creates changes in our society but also delivers high quality education? Now, several of the unions objected. I engaged in great detail with the unions. We have now come to a compromise position. We are working our way through the levels of progression. Engagements with the unions will continue, and I believe that will only be for the betterment of creating a levels of progression which all young, with all schools and unions can be comfortable with, and also ensures that the education department, the executive, the assembly, and all those who, others who are tasked with looking after public money can be satisfied that it's well invested.
Paul Girvan is not in his place. I call Barry McIlduff.
Since 2013-14, my department has cooperated with the Department of Education and Skills in the South in running an all-island history competition for schools to commemorate the decades of centenaries. As part of the Ireland 2016 programme to commemorate events of 1916, which of which the Easter Rising is one, three all-island school competitions will be held this year in history, drama and art. The cross-curricular nature of these competitions provides opportunities for pupils to learn about the important period in our history. Additionally, the Council for Curriculum Examinations and Assessments is working on a 1916 mutual understanding programme for schools with the objective of providing curricular support and materials for teachers and learners that will allow them to explore the history and legacy of events associated with the 1916 year of centenaries, including the Rising and the Battle of the Somme. I have agreed to provide funding of up to £45,000 for this work by SEA in 16-17.
I call Barry McIlduff for supplementary.
Okay. Can I ask the Minister, in commemorating the 2016 year of centenaries, important milestone historic anniversaries, that schools feel equally comfortable about looking at the 1916 Easter Rising as perhaps they might do at the First World War?
The All-Ireland competition we're running with the Department of Education in the South, the funding I'm providing to SEA is to ensure that schools can look at both those significant events in the centenaries of 1916 in terms of the Rising and the Battle of the Somme. There are schools that will choose to look at both events. There may be schools who choose to look at one or other of the events. I know in terms of my own experience, of my own school children, of my own children, the conversations around the dinner table, revolve around the 1916 Rising to the First World War. And I think that's very interesting. One of my sons asked me, was I around during the First World War? And I had to convince him I wasn't. So there's opportunities for schools to look at both the major events of 1916 going through 1916 or singular events. Personally, I would encourage them to look at both.
I call Ross Hussey.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Does the Minister agree that great care must be taken not to glorify the mistakes of history? For example, in the Easter Rising, one of those first killed was a Dublin Metropolitan Police officer who was killed in cold blood. So would he agree with me that great care must be taken not to glorify the mistakes of history?
Well, history is one of those issues which there's always different opinions on in terms of events around history. It's clear that death occurred on the streets of Dublin as it did around the banks of the Somme. There are many studies and views as to whether either of those battles was necessary in around that period, and the great loss of life, whether it be in the First World War or in the Easter Rising and the preceding War of Independence, was inevitable or was necessary, it may be. I want to ensure that schools have an informed debate, that they're comfortable in that debate, that they engage with each other, and yes, we learn from the mistakes of history, but it's not only school children that need to do that. Adults in this chamber could also do well from learning from the mistakes of history as well.
I call Nelson McCausland.
Thank you. Thank the Minister for his answer. In Ulster in 1916, there was no rebellion because the rebels gathered in Tyrone, and apart from accidentally shooting two of themselves when their guns went off accidentally, they simply came home on the train after making a train journey to Tyrone. Will the Minister be able to assure us that that information will be incorporated in the same material?
Well, the history of the Rising will be interpreted by schools and taught through schools. I don't provide the material to schools to say you must teach it in this way. It's open to interpretation from the schools and what information they gather in. But of course the member will be aware there was a rebellion in the six counties. The UVF were still armed to the teeth. The UVF still had the guns they landed in 1913, and they were still threatening war against the British state if Home Rule was, in their words, imposed, or if partition was not taking place. So there was a rebellion. It was a rebellion on the other side of the argument, perhaps, but there were certainly those who were hoarding guns.
Order.
There were certainly those who were hoarding guns. There was those who were planning armed uprising, and there was those who were threatening to carry out violence against the King and his forces. But now, the member may want to write that out of history. I don't. History doesn't scare me. Learning about history doesn't scare me. Learning about the mistakes of history doesn't scare me. Learning about other people's perspective of history doesn't scare me. What scares me is that we make the mistakes of history from the past.
Moving on, I call Sandra Overend.
Question 6, please.
Following the executive agreement of Budget 16-17 on Thursday, the 17th of December 2015, which was subsequently passed by the Assembly on the 19th of January 2016, I am currently working through the impact of the Budget 2016-17 outcome on the education sector and have not yet come to any final decisions in relation to that. The budget settlement for education is challenging, partly as a result of the real terms reduction to the executive resource budget by the Westminster Government. However, the position for education is significantly better than previously anticipated. My aim is to have reached final decisions on my department's budget allocations within the next number of weeks and to allow for early notifications to schools.
I call Sandra Overend.
Thank you, and I thank the Minister for his answer. The Minister will be aware that schools work to a three-year budget cycle, and as it stands, they don't know what their budget will be for the 2016-17 year. Has he given any consideration in the 5 years that he's been Minister to do something about this and to change it?
Perhaps my memory is playing tricks with me, but I remember, or do I recall, the Welsh Unionist Party challenging the executive over its four-year CSR budget, and you called for a year-on-year budget settlement rather than producing a four-year budget at the start of this mandate. I think the Welsh Unionist Party, and I believe your colleagues in the SDLP, also opposed a four-year budget at the start. We are in a one-year budget cycle because we are facing into an end-of-mandate election. There will be an election in May, there will be a new mandate, there will be a new executive, and it will be up to the new executive to approve, if it so wishes, a budget period over 4 years. Then schools will have certainty around what their budget is like for the coming period in the three-year plan. This is a unique position we're in. We have, as I said, the election's coming, we have to set the budget, and there's nothing we can do about it at this stage.
I call Ian Milne.
Ashman Collier, thank you, Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister to maybe give us a little bit more information on what impact will the increased capital budget have on schools within the 16-17 financial year?
The increase in the capital budget is actually a good news story in terms of education. We've seen quite a significant increase in the capital budget for education, both in terms of normal capital and also the injection of the money from the Fresh Start Agreement in relation to £50 million per annum for shared and integrated education and indeed shared housing. So the minor works backlog, hopefully we'll be able to work our way through a significant part of the minor works backlog, which is built up this year. We are moving ahead with a significant new school build programme, and we're also moving ahead with an SEP programme, a school enhancement programme as well. Indeed, I hope to be in a position in the coming weeks to announce several more projects that will be moving on to site shortly.
Moving on, I call Trevor Clark.
Question number 7.
I'm committed to ensuring that schools' estate plays its part in reducing greenhouse gas emissions and improving energy efficiency. I am therefore continuing to consider investment in gas conversions. With the budget available to me and within the availability of the natural gas network, in the 14-15 financial year I invested £10 million on a range of energy efficient projects across the school's estate, including the conversion of oil-fired to gas-fired heatings in 16 schools.
I call Trevor Clark for supplementary.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer, and I mean welcome the fact that he is looking at energy efficiency within our schools. I had a recent meeting, Minister, with Firmus Energy, who is providers in South Antrim area, and was alarmed to find the number of schools that hadn't converted to gas. And given we hear quite often in the headlines about schools where oil has been stolen, I suppose really what I'm appealing for the Minister to do more in relation to particular areas where gas is available for them. What assurance can the Minister give me today that he will do more for the schools within each of the constituencies where gas is available to give them security of supply?
I noticed comments on security of supply, but at the moment, given that oil prices are so low, I suspect that many schools are quite happy to continue with oil-fired central heating, though I and note the comments in relation to green energy and energy efficiency, etc. Energy markets, as a member will know, fluctuate. Gas is also a reasonable price at the moment. World affairs can have a major impact on gas prices as well. So it is a topsy-turvy sort of economy in relation to predicting what future prices will be. But I am working, my department works with the Education Authority and the other managing authorities in relation to conversions. We will make budgets available as we can moving forward to ensure that our schools have the most up-to-date energy systems.
I call Oliver McMullen.
Can I ask the Minister to outline the number of schools who currently operate with gas-fired heating?
There are currently 739 sites on the education estate connected to the natural gas network. This includes schools, school meals, accommodation, youth clubs and administration buildings. I will provide the member with a full breakdown of the schools involved in that number by writing.
Moving on, I call Declan McAleer.
For transfer 2016, 62 post-primary schools are using children's results in unregulated tests as a basis for year 8 admissions. While some schools appear to be wedded to the outdated notion of testing children for admissions, an increasing number of grammar schools have chosen to abandon academic selection. St McNeish's College dropped selection in March 2010, meaning it amalgamated with two other County Antrim schools to become St Killian's College. Loretto College in Coleraine has been operating successfully as a non-selective grammar school since September 2012. St Patrick's Grammar in Armagh has abandoned academic selection, and St Ronan's College in Lurgan, which opened in September 2015, operates as a non-selective grammar school. More Catholic grammar schools have announced they are exploring the possibility of moving in the same direction. Loretto Grammar School in Omagh and Omagh Christian Brothers Grammar School have signalled that they wish to move away from academic selection on a phased basis, while plans are being developed in Fermanagh that could lead to the end of academic selection at Mount Lourdes Grammar and St Michael's College in Enniskillen. St Louis Grammar School in Kilkeel are also exploring the possibility of moving away from academic selection. Furthermore, I will shortly be making a decision on development proposals that proposes the phased ending of academic selection in Dominican College, Port Stewart.
I call Declan McAleer for supplementary.
Thanks to the Minister for his answer. The Minister made reference to a number of schools in the Omagh area which have forwarded proposals to move away from academic selection. Could the Minister outline what impact he believes that this will have on education provision in the local area?
Given that these development proposals are live in the sense that there's pre-consultation and then we'll go to publication, it would be inappropriate for me to comment on them specifically, but I do note in other areas where academic selection has been brought to an end that the schools continue to prosper, that the educational outcomes for the young people in the area continue to prosper, and it proves that you do not require academic selection to have a high quality education system for our young people.
I call Gerard Diver.
Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for the information about those schools that are trying to move away from the transfer test, but can I ask the Minister specifically what support is being given to those schools that are attempting to move away from the practice of these transfer tests?
It will depend on each case in relation to whether it's an amalgamation or whether it's a closure on the beginning of a new school. It will depend on how the schools move away from it, but it's noted those schools that have taken the step forward have not seen the predicted decline in numbers. They have not seen the predicted decline in support from the local community, and they have not seen the predicted decline in academic results or indeed the educational results of the young people in the schools. I would encourage those boards of governors out there who are considering this matter, or those who are not considering it, to sit down and have a real conversation about how they believe they are contributing to the educational well-being of the entire community, not just some of the community, because I believe that those schools who have taken the step forward have shown the doubters that world-class education can and is provided in the absence of academic selection.
And that ends the period of time for listed questions, and we now move on to topical questions. And I call John Dallett.
Mr Deputy Speaker, I'm sure the Minister agrees with me that, against the background of teachers not able to find jobs, classrooms overcrowded, bad maintenance, that millions of pounds is given to schools where the boards of governors have, rather than created posts, have suspended teachers for up to 3 years, only to bring 99% of them back into service after millions of pounds has been wasted. What is the Minister going to do about that?
We have an education system and education legislation that devolves a significant amount of power down to boards of governors, and the board of governors are the employing authority of the school in terms of day-to-day management of the school. The management of staff is the responsibility of board of governors in relation to schools, so therefore it is the responsibility of firstly the managing authorities, whether it be the education authority, CCMS, but also boards of governors, to ensure that suspensions are dealt with as quickly as possible, and that all rights are respected of those staff that are suspended, and those who have made allegations against staff have suspended, their rights are protected as well. Once you get into that, you can end up with quite significant delays in dealing with sometimes very, very complicated accusations against staff or vice versa, whatever it may be, and that's when you end up with lengthy suspensions. But I do believe that more can be done to shorten the length of suspension, both in terms of the morale of the staff that are suspended, those who have made accusations, or it may be that they're dealt with quickly, but also in terms of saving money for the public purse.
I call John Dallet for a supplement.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, you might be principal in the next assembly. I'm not sure if I'm hearing the Minister right, but attempting to be positive, is the Minister telling us that monitoring of this was totally deficient in the past, and that he is going to ensure that monitoring of all schools, because I understand many of the schools are not monitored at all, is he going to convince the world at large that the £4.2 million squandered in the last 5 years will not be repeated?
Well, I wonder if the members ever made any representations on behalf of a suspended teacher.
Yes, no
way. Right, okay. So therefore, then, you accept and defend the right of suspended teachers to be treated fairly and equally under employment legislation and under the rules that are govern their school, right? So I'm not sure, where do you draw the line under the £4.2 million that's been wasted? Is it the staff that you represented, the money wasn't wasted on them, but the staff you didn't represent, the money was wasted on that side of the argument? So where do we draw the line? I am being told by schools that they have to go through these procedures, and that they are honouring the rights and entitlements of the teacher, of the member of staff. They're honouring the rights and entitlements of the person who made the complaint, or the complaint, or where the complaint come from. So once you get into all that technical stuff, it can end up very protracted and very long. Now, was it monitored properly in the past? I think it could have been monitored more closely. I have asked my officials to bring forward more proposals as to how we ensure that monitoring goes on, how we support schools and boards of governors to ensure that they have all the information and support at hand to deal with these matters as quickly as possible. But the bottom line is this: people have rights and entitlements under the law, and when it comes to suspensions, you will find that they quite rightly use them.
Could I ask that all remarks be made through the chair in order that Hansard will be able to pick everything up appropriately? I call Anna Lowe.
Thank you. Mr. Deputy Speaker, can I ask the Minister why the approved school enrolment figures are not included on the Department's School Plus website?
I don't know, is the honest answer. We do provide data through the education authorities in relation to every school, in relation to a school profile, which should provide enrolment numbers at schools, the budget position of schools, number of children entitled to free school meal, entitlement at school, etc., etc. And that is available through the Education Authority's website.
Confession he doesn't know. Can I ask the Minister as soon as possible to check on that website? And it is important that such very important information is listed on the website.
I certainly will check for the member, and it may be the case that we're relying on the school profiles, which are published, as I said, for every school on the Education Authority website, but I will follow the matter up.
Alistair Ross is not in his place. I call Sandra Overend.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I wonder, can the Minister comment on the BBC UK headline news story, Northern Ireland students among poorest skilled in developed world countries, which referred to a news story from an OECD report, albeit wrongly interpreted?
Well, the member has answered her own questions in many ways. I believe there was a printing error or some other mishap in relation to the report and the details which were given to the media, and the media quite rightly reported the information they were given, but that was wrong, and it did present our students in a very dim light, which was unfortunate and unacceptable. And I have already received a letter of apology from OECD in relation to this matter, but it should never have happened in the first place.
I call Sandra O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for that. And I appreciate the OECD has sent the Minister an apology, but the damage is maybe nearly done already with this in regard to how far this story has gone across the world. I mean, it was on the UK BBC website. How far has that gone? So really my question is, what has the Minister done? What does the Minister plan to do to get the message out across the world that actually Northern Ireland students are highly skilled? Because it really can be damaging to our Northern Ireland economy.
I'm not always a great defender of the media, but as soon as the BBC were made aware of this matter, they did publish the OECD's retraction on their website. I published a statement myself welcoming the clarification around the qualifications and abilities of our young people and expressing my severe disappointment with OECD in relation to the publication of the figures. It did make headlines, thankfully only for a 24-hour period, but the correction is now in place and we will be able to allay anyone's fears in relation, or investors' fears in relation to that matter. The figures OECD provided were completely wrong and it was a great disservice to our young people. And the apology which I have received from OECD is not necessarily to me, it's to our young people and to our students who perform so well in their study. So any opportunity I come across, I will certainly ensure that anyone's misconceptions about our education system will be corrected.
I call Gregory Campbell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can the Minister update us on what progress is being made on major refurbishment and capital rebuild of primary and post-primary schools across Northern Ireland, but especially in East Londonderry?
As I said in the previous questions, we have quite a significant building programme going on at the moment, both in terms of capital and SEP programmes. Of a number of programmes in the members' constituency moving forward, we have Rossmore Special School in Limavady. We have Our Lady of Fatima, formerly Craig Beck PS, Mullaboy PS, Lestress in Derry. We have those are the two or the three projects which are jumping out at me at the moment. If there's any more, I'd certainly inform Mr. Campbell by writing.
I call Gregory Campbell for supplementary.
Yeah, I noticed that the Minister was looking down the list with increasing concern that he wasn't getting any more than the ones that were there. But he didn't seem to have a difficulty in getting capital sums to support capital works in Dungiven for three local children for an Irish language school in East Londonderry. So can the same vigour and concern apply to both maintained and controlled sectors as was applied there, and with much more relevance and poignancy for the numbers of pupils and parents alike concerned?
The issue in relation to investment, I could stand here and read out the list of projects which are being built across the north, and the member will find that there is equality and fair play for everyone in relation to that. In relation to the member's own constituency, perhaps, he would like to inform me of which schools he has been lobbying on and which ones I have torn down for him, because I don't recall the member lobbying that strongly for any schools in his constituency, and perhaps that may be the case. When we come to a capital announcement, what I will do is I will go to the previous education boards, to CCMS and the other managing authorities, and I will ask them to bring forward a list of priority schools under their management. We will then run that through the system and we will match the schools that come out the other side in relation to the budget we have at that time. And we have made a significant investment across the various schools across the north over this last number of years, and we will continue to do so. So perhaps the member would like to write to me in relation to which schools he feels have been left behind in his constituency.
William Irwin is not in this place. I call Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. An earlier question referred to conversion from oil to gas in terms of greening the school estate. There's a great school in West Belfast, St Mary's Grammar School in the Glen Road, that has a wind turbine. Is the Minister aware of any other conversions within the school estate to wind turbine and away from fossil fuels?
Not off the top of my head. There's a number of schools who have been very innovative in relation to their energy consumption and preserving energy in relation to their schools. Our new build programme, I have to say, is very energy conscious and very energy efficient, ensuring that schools are able to monitor the amount of energy they are using and be able to reduce even energy consumption over that period of time. But I don't have at hand a list of those schools that have converted to wind energy.
I call Alex Atwood.
DOE run a scheme whereby virtually every primary school in Northern Ireland is an eco school. Is it not time, given the challenge of climate change and the green of the public estate generally in Northern Ireland, that there are interventions to encourage schools to seek planning permission and to build wind turbines as part of their contribution to environmental change?
Schools, as you said, and the vast majority of our primary schools have the eco flag flying from them, and schools are very active in relation to these matters. If the member is suggesting that the department takes it on as a project, if the department takes it on as a project, then it's another project we have to let go somewhere else. It's also a require investment in relation to those matters, which means we have to let something go somewhere else in relation to that. So, all these are competing priorities. I believe at this stage our schools estate, the best way forward is in relation to investment in its capital upgrade and its building infrastructure upgrade, and we're having quite great good success in relation to that.
I call William Humphrey.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker, and thank the Minister for his answer so far. Minister, my colleague Nigel Dodds and I recently met with parent representatives from Little Flower Post-Primary School in North Belfast. The Board of Governors there are united in that the school should be retained. The Minister will also be aware a petition was recently presented to this Assembly. Sadly, however, CCMS refused to meet the parents' representatives and the Governors. Can I ask the Minister, will he commit to this House to meet with parents' representatives and politicians representing North Belfast?
If the member cares to write to me on that matter, I will certainly take it under consideration. There is proposals around a development proposal for that area. If my memory serves me right, and it may not be the case, the consultation for that area may have closed in around the 19th of January. But if that's not the case, then if the member writes to me, we can facilitate a meeting.
I call William Humphrey for
Minister for that response, and I certainly will endeavour to do that. Can I just say to the Minister that it's my understanding that the parents of Little Flower and the parents of St Patrick's are both keen on the retention of both those schools as single-sex post-primary schools in North Belfast, and he should be aware that that is a viewpoint that's held widely across the community in North Belfast, and obviously in particular from the parents of the pupils attending both schools.
I take the member's comments on board, and when it comes to changes in the school estate, it always or can often result in a keen interest in the community, which is a good thing. I always take on board the views and commentary of local parents and local representatives in regards to that matter.
And that is the end of our time for topical questions. I could ask members to take their ease for a few minutes.